that this is a debate of academic nature. It doesn't represent people's personal point of views, which makes it all the more interesting. Which makes it all the more interesting because we, in an academic institution, should be able to debate ideas from all points of view, and I'm very grateful to be invited here. But before starting on the rebuttal, I just want to point out what an honor it is to be on the stage with Dr. Pervez Woolboy. I'll start with the rebuttal and then I'll make my argument in the hope that the emotion of the other side will not convince you to make the argument, the intellect of it would be. I had a criminal law professor who used to say that if you have the law on your side, you should argue the law. If you have the facts on your side, you should argue the facts. And if you have neither on your side, you should thump your fist on the rostrum and loud scream as loudly as you can. And I hope that you will get it. I'll start with the rebuttal. I'll keep looking at my papers for the rebuttal because it's only natural K. Now that I've made the claim that we're going to stick to somewhat of the facts as opposed to arguing the emotions of the crowd here. And by the way, this is a very smart strategy. A pretty smart strategy is that you come to a liberal college and you have to go to a mall and leave the college. I'm about to start the rebuttal. You know, use it now. I'm happy for you to do it. I got one question.
Jeezy. You're liberal college.
Yes. Worthy chair, I just want to say that now they've used their one question. So, I'll start with.
Worthy chair, that's all we needed, anyways.
I'll start with. Guys, I'm on a bit of a clock here. I'll start with Dr. Pervez Woolboy's rebuttal. Dr. Pervez, and I've already said this is only by virtue of the debate.
Pervez will not do anything.
Dr. Pervez Woolboy said, do you want a Pakistan in which Mishal Khan events happen and in which people are browbeated on the streets and in which Mumtaz Qadri is the only hero? My question, sir, is that what part of that claim relates to the question of the debate today? There is no part. There is no. Do we want a Pakistan in which Mishal Khan events happen? No, absolutely not. But does that mean that the concession of the government was wrong? The two are absolutely independent. Kya aapko mujhe Mishal Khan ke events chahiye? Nahi chahiye. Kya aapko mujhe Khadim Hussain Rizvi pasand hai? Nahi pasand. کیا آپ اور میں اس جلسے کے اندر گئے تھے اور وہاں پہ شامل رہیں گے یا آئندہ کبھی جائیں گے نہیں جائیں گے سوال یہ ہے ہی نہیں سوال یہ ہے کہ کیا حکومت کا کنسیشن ٹھیک تھا یا نہیں تھا بس یہ سوال ہے اور آج کا آپ کا ووٹ بھی خادم حسین رضوی کی اچھائی یا برائی کے اوپر نہیں ہوگا اس چیز کے اوپر نہیں ہوگا whether you want مشال خان پاکستان اور you want ممتاز قادری پاکستان that's not the point of the debate what you have witnessed from the other side is misdirection is absolute misdirection. The question before you is printed on this podium, which says, does the government's concession to Tehreek-e-Labbaik is harmful to national interest? Jibran sahab ne end mein, aur Jibran sahab ka rebuttal mein Urdu mein hi karunga taake...
Qaumi zubaan mein fakhr hona chahiye.
Ji, lekin jin ne angrezi mein baat ki, unka rebuttal angrezi mein hoga, jinhonne... Jibran sahab ne national interest ke upar zarur baat ki, but at least for the first two speakers, no part of their argument, while it was emotive, while it was emotional, while it asked pointed questions, no part of it, to my understanding...
No, but you missed...
Sir, the point of order is done, which is why... Hold on. We're gonna stick to the rules for the reason that I gave you the option. I asked you... Miss Gul Bukhari said to you not once, not twice, but to my count, she said 9 times to you. If 1,500 people 1500 people from here go on and go outside and make this, can we have the government fall? For anybody in this country who thinks that there were just 1500 people and nobody behind them, in every street corner, in every mosque, in every town in Pakistan, they've entirely missed the boat on reality. The reason government will not listen to 1500 people from here is because we will just be 1500 people. The 1500 people who gathered in Faizabad were not 1500 people. They were 15,000, they were 150,000, they were 1.5 million, they were 15 million, maybe they were 150 million. They were not 1500 people. And let's not mix facts with assertions here on this.
Yeah, let's again, not mix imagination.
You've already
Now,
Jibran Nasir saab ki ek bahut zyada mere dost bhi hain, ek bahut achhi ki quality hai, aur wo ye hai ki rhetorical speech bahut achhi karte hain. Ek baat ko baar baar karte hain mere and parliamentary debaters are supposed to sort of knock down on him a little bit. To Jibran saab ki badi ek quality hai ki wo aapko ek aisi emotional takreer karenge ki aapko lagega ki waqai Kashmir kabhi nahi banega DHA aur main mashallah. तो इन्होंने आपको बताया अपनी तकरीर के अंदर कि नेशनल इंटरेस्ट क्या नहीं है. Now I'm going to come to my topic because rebuttal is effectively done. इन्होंने आपको बताया नेशनल इंटरेस्ट क्या नहीं है. फातिमा भुट्टो को गद्दार डिक्लेयर कर देना नेशनल इंटरेस्ट नहीं था. फातिमा जनाब को डिक्लेयर सर फॉर योर कंजम्पशन सर जस्ट फॉर जिब्रान्स पार्ट आई एम गोना स्पीक इन उर्दू एंड द रेस्ट विल कम बैक टू इंग्लिश. इन्होंने आपको बताया कि क्या क्या नेशनल इंटरेस्ट नहीं था. पाकिस्तान का दो हिस्से में हो जाना नेशनल इंटरेस्ट था, नहीं था. क्या बलूचिस्तान के अंदर कत्लो गारत नेशनल इंटरेस्ट है, नहीं है. इसमें किसी की दो राय नहीं है. जो चीजें आपको नहीं बता सकते ना सिर्फ ये नहीं बता सकते बल्कि उस तरफ बैठा हुआ कोई शख्स नहीं बता सकता, इस तरफ बैठा कोई शख्स नहीं बता सकता, मैं नहीं बता सकता, आप नहीं बता सकते कंसेंसस से, वो ये कि नेशनल इंटरेस्ट है क्या. अगर मैं यहां पर पर्चियां पास करूं सबको और कहूं कि नेशनल इंटरेस्ट की डेफिनेशन लिख दें, अगर किसी दो बंदे की डेफिनेशन एक दूसरे से नहीं मिलेगी. सो व्हाट इज नेशनल इंटरेस्ट, लेट्स कम डाउन टू वेदर इन ऑर्डर टू डिटरमिन वेदर द कंसेशन दैट वाज डन बाय द गवर्नमेंट वेदर इट इज इन नेशनल इंटरेस्ट. जिब्रान इज एब्सोल्युटली राइट, लेट्स स्टार्ट विद डिफाइनिंग नेशनल इंटरेस्ट. Jibran Nasir will be able to define what is not national interest. He will not be able to tell you what national interest is for the reason that in 70 years we've not been able to come up with a public definition for it. So now let's figure out, in order to assert this question as to what is or is whether the concession was or was not a national interest, let's define or attempt to define what national interest is. Let's start first by saying that national interest can only be defined by three basic broad categories. Because I'm up against like absolutely formidable opponents, so I keep looking towards my notes because they're all in rebuttal. So let's say that three different institutions, broadly speaking, three different institutions can define national interest. One is the government, however you want to call it. There are no three branches in Pakistan, there are only two branches because the parliament and the legislature and the executive are all effectively one branch. Both of them sit in the legislature. So one is the government. It's possible for the government to define national interest. Second is the military. It is possible for the military to define national interest. And the third is the people, right? Those are the only three ways in a state structure to define national interest. We don't like the government's national interest. Certainly the other side doesn't. I don't. Let's not accept whatever their definition is because their definition changes from time to time. We certainly don't like the military here, as was apparent from the clapping that profusely took place, and young man here nodded his head. I thought it was going to come off. So let's not take their definition. Fine. Let's stick to the people's definition. How do the people define national interest? No. I need a little bit of your attention. And the reason I need your attention is because the other side doesn't have anything to go by in terms of law, in terms of facts. All they have is an emotional speech, which they've made tremendously so. But let's come back to how this debate is to be decided. Now, the people define national interest through the law and the constitution. And the law and the constitution interpreted through the judiciary. In any democratic structure, that's the only way to define national interest. What can't happen, Ms. Prabhupari, I repeatedly gave you an opportunity. What can't happen is that people come out, sorry, I just need 5 minutes, that's fine. What can't happen is that people come out every day and say, so, what do you think that this is in national interest, and there's a show of hand all across Pakistan, and then somebody goes around and counts, yes it is, no it's not, yes it is, no it's not, and then comes up with a list saying, yes, the people of Pakistan think this is national interest. We can't do that 7 times a day, just can't do it. So the national interest is defined as to what is prohibited and not prohibited in the law, what is allowed and not allowed in the constitution, what is or is not illegal, what is or is not unconstitutional as interpreted by the court. That's our national interest. That's the full definition of a neutral definition of national interest. It's not the government's definition, it's not the military's definition. So let's read the 6 demands and come and answer this question. Let's read the 6 demands that Tehreek-e-Labbaik ke saath settle hui. First, resignation of the law minister. Is it unconstitutional to seek a resignation of a minister? Is it illegal? I don't want you to answer whether you like Zahid Ahmed or not. That's not the question. Point of order has been done.
Just a request. Can you read the demands and that
first? I'll read the Urdu demands as well. But in the interest of time, I'm going to summarize them. I'll read the first demand just to make sure that you all understand that I've accurately summarized here, but then I'll read the summary, huh? And I'll request another minute, please, on my time on this. So the first demand is, Wazir-e-Qanun Zahid Hamid ki wazarat ke zariye is kanun mein tarmeem pesh ki gayi. فوری اپنے عہدے سے برطرف یا مستعفی کیا جائے تحریک لبیک ان کے خلاف کسی قسم کا کوئی فتویٰ جاری نہیں کرے گی دیٹس دا فرسٹ ڈیمانڈ ہولڈ آن دیٹس دا فرسٹ ڈیمانڈ از اٹ اف وی آل گیٹ ٹوگیدر when a bunch of politicians got together and sought Nawaz Sharif's disqualification, what was the argument for it? The argument was, it's not unconstitutional to seek a politician's disqualification. It's not unconstitutional, it's not against the law, and national interest is neither what the government says, nor what the military says, but what the constitution and the law is. It's not unconstitutional. Amend the law 2017. Is it bad to say that you should amend the law? You may agree or disagree with the law. We amend laws all the time. We pass new laws all the time. Is it bad? Is demand number 2 bad? Is it unconstitutional? Is it illegal? It's not. Release the people who are politically arrested. Release the people who are politically arrested. Every time, whether it was the lawyers movement, Ahmed and I were in the were part of the lawyers movement, we were arrested. I was arrested once in Faisalabad, then I don't know about Ahmed or not.
Twice.
Not twice. The first thing that any public movement does is that now that we've reached a settlement, we don't want to go through any bloodshed, we should release our people. Inquiry against the operation done. That's the next demand. Inquiry against the operation done. Payment for expenses, by the way, this is something Gibran is gonna go on and on about. Payment for expenses should be made by the government. This is something that was debated a great deal. Is it unconstitutional? If you reverse it, what would happen? Should every protesting people first check their wallet and say, well, you know, Ahmed, you and I, we should go protest on Lalit Chowk, it's going to cost us ₹1,000 to do it. Is that how we should do it? Or should the government have to pay for the people's right to protest? Whose cost should it be? If people started paying, agar ye baat sach ho, کہ لوگوں سے پیسے لیے جائیں گے ان کے پروٹیسٹ کرنے کے, تو مزدور کبھی پروٹیسٹ کر سکے گا اس ملک میں؟ کیا فقیر کبھی پروٹیسٹ کر سکے گا؟ how much time do I have?
None.
I have two minutes. It's great to talk about religion in an emotive manner. It's great to talk about religion. I'm going to sort of come out because this is now we're done. It's great to talk about religion in an emotive manner. Should Ahmadis be declared non-Muslims? No, they should not be. Should Brailvis, as Dr. Pervez Boy said, should Brailvis take over the world? No, they should not. As Gibran Nasir said, has the Quran and the Sunnah been misinterpreted in this country? I'm a Shia. I absolutely believe this. Yes, it has been. But is that the question of the mood today? Is that the question of the mood today? I'll ask for a show of hands. Please don't actually do it, but I'll ask for a show of hands. How many people think that Islam is being misinterpreted in the country? And I'll raise my own. How many people think that fundamentalism should not be a part of this country? I'll raise my own. How many people will not vote for Tahriq-e-Labbaik Ya Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? I'll raise my own hand. But that's not the question here. The question before you is, was the concession by the government, unconstitutional? And the answer, against national interest, and the answer is no, not at all. Before parting here, we cannot deny the fact, neither can the other side deny the fact, that it saved lives those that day. You may disagree with it, you may not like the manner in which it saved lives, but it saved lives that day. There's no question about the fact that it saved lives that day. So I leave you all, before you cast your vote, before you cast your vote, I leave you all with a question or with a thought about saving lives. There's this famous story. There's this famous story in this six-volume book called The Fall of the Roman Empire. It was written, first of all, in the early 1800s and translated into the UN mission in the early 1900s. And this book has this great story about the Persian army that had attacked the Roman army. And so the Roman forces, I'll just take 30 more seconds, please, before you vote. So the Persian army had made a siege to Rome. Everybody, and for Jibran Sahib, I'll say it in Urdu as well. The Persian army, meaning the... Let's all understand. It's just a... Persian army had made a siege to the Roman, to the city of Rome, or Bahar, un logon ne pickets wagaira laga di thi. It was a siege. Roman army under the command, please listen up, Roman army under the command of Caesar goes out and starts to fight an absolutely losing battle. Lo and behold, they start winning and the Persian army starts retreating. Before, as was the convention in those olden days, before the battle started, Caesar had ordered that everybody from outside Rome should come into the city walls and in the city so that the civilian population could be saved. Nobody, no civilian was outside. As the Persian army was retreating, there was like a 400-500-yard distance between the retreating Persian army and the advancing Roman army. And suddenly, a young boy on a chariot comes from nowhere and enters the field. Caesar says to his forces, "You should stop." And the general says to him, "But Caesar, we have them on the run." Caesar says, "But it'll kill the young boy." And the general says, "Is Rome worth one good man's life?" And Caesar says, "It's not." So if one good life was saved that day, because of government's concession, I urge you to vote in favor of the opposition.